my granddaddy.
We'll send the offering plates around in just a moment. Or we also have a box on the back of the wall if you'd rather put it in there. These prayer requests go right to our prayer team, and they pray for these things on Wednesday nights. We would love to know what's going on in your life or someone else's. But also, if there's been any updates, any prayer requests you've given to us before, any praises you'd like to give us, we'll take those too. But anything going on in your life or someone else's, let us know about that so we can join you in prayer with that. And also, on the next week, okay, a couple of new things. Wednesday night, we're going to have our candlelight service here at 6 o'clock, correct? Yes, 6 o'clock. 6:30. I'm going to tell you 6, so you get here early, and you'll get here 6:15 and think you're late, and that's okay. So, it's 6 o'clock, right? 6:30, I'm going to throw everybody off. That's all right. Everyone who's in the candlelight, be here at 6 or 5:30 if you need that. But I'm an early guy. I'd rather be way too early than way too late. But anyhow, Wednesday night, we'd love to have you here for our candlelight service. If you have other churches or anything like that, we want to support you with that. But if you don't have anything else to do on Wednesday night, we'd love to have you come here. It won't be very long. It's a great time of worship and things like that. And we'll finish out our candle lighting and things like that. So we'd love to have you Wednesday night at 6:30. Now, next Sunday, especially for those of you who are regular attenders and things like that, we will not be having Sunday school on the 24th or the 31st, the next two Sundays. We'll just have our regular worship time, but it'll be at 10:30 instead, okay? Now listen, everybody look at me. If you get here at 11 thinking, oh no, I forgot, you just come on in and act like natural, okay? We won't mind if you're here a little bit late because we moved the time on you. We'd rather have you here late than never at all, okay? So that's the next two Sundays, but for today, we're so glad you're here. We have a few things that we're going to do first. We have been praying for lostness this whole fall, and when we talk about lostness, this is just basically people separated from God. Because of lostness, you are no longer a part of God's family, you're separated from Him, and you're separated for an eternity. And we're praying about that, and each week we have a different focus, and this week our focus is the world as a whole. And if you watch the news, you know that we could use the hand of God in a lot of places and a lot of ways. And it hasn't gotten any better since I've grown up. And that's been a while. But still, there's plenty to pray about in this world. But I will tell you this. Jesus Christ came because he loved the world. Those people that we don't even know all the way across this globe, God knew every one of them. He knew it before they were even born, the Bible says. He knitted their bones together in their mother's womb. He loves them so much that he gave his only son to die in their place at the cross of Calvary, just like he did for you and me. So we want to pray for that in just a moment when we pray for these things. But also, I want to give this verse to you. If you're a regular attendee, you're familiar with this, but visitors, I want you to know this verse because this is God's word. This is a truth of God's word that you can live eternally by. So will you stand and join us? And let's all say this verse together out loud. Join me as we say this. And there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. Acts 4:12. Will you pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this time to come together. Lord, thank you for this reason to come together, that we would worship you. Father, thank you for loving us, for giving your Son Jesus, who died in our place at the cross of Calvary. Lord, I pray that you be with us now during this worship time. Lord, whatever reason brought us in here, Lord, it was still your hand at work. And I pray, Father, today we will be open to listen to you speak to us. Father, you know every heart and mind and life in here. Father, you know every family, you know every individual. Father, you care for each and every one of us, and there's something today that we need to hear. Father, whether it be in the sermon, the songs, the prayers, the baptisms, or even just a person sitting beside us, I pray, Father, we would be open and listening to that. Thank you again for loving us, for dying on our place at the cross of Calvary, and Father, also for this offering we're about to take. Father, I pray that every cent that is given, it would be used to glorify your name, not just right here, but all across the planet. Thank you again for loving us. It's in your name we pray, Lord. Amen. Amen.
Good morning. Sing this out with us.
What child is this?
Children of a different country from human trafficking. And he was able to save over 200 kids, all completely on his own and with the help of the other country. But there was one line that stuck out in the movie that I have embedded in me, and it was, when God tells you to do something, do not hesitate. If we hesitate for one moment, that can change the time. We don't know when it'll change, but hesitation is a spirit of fear. Oh, what will they think of me? A spirit of doubt. Me and four other people, who I won't name names, have been praying covenant prayer. And if you don't know what a covenant prayer is, it is a prayer where you make a promise to God to pray at the same time, no matter where you're at. And our time has been 9:30 at night after we put the kids to bed, so that we have no distractions. But what we have been praying for is that God does a revival in this church. And we're not praying for it for more people. We're praying it so that it's a spiritual revival within our hearts. Because whenever we don't let things go, whenever we don't surrender things at the feet of Jesus, out of fear, a spirit of fear, a spirit of pride, a spirit of bitterness, a spirit of unforgiveness. Well, you don't know what they did to me. They hurt me really bad. I have trauma because of them. God knows. I know. But the only person that's hurting is you. Because I want you to be who I called you to be. You have a purpose. You have a calling for your life. And every minute that you hold on to that, don't give it to me, you are wasting time, because the devil is here to kill, steal, and destroy. If he can't kill you, if he can't destroy you, he's going to steal what? Your time. He's going to steal your time. And it's going to be with distraction, petty things, fleshly things. When we don't lay down our flesh at the feet of Jesus and surrender to him, then we are robbing ourselves of the purpose he has placed on our lives to be a light out in this world. We're not supposed to be like the world. And so this next song, I felt like Corey needed to lead this song. It sounded like Corey. And Corey is an amazing person. If you ever get the chance to hear his testimony, I am praying for revival and the renewal of our hearts. And listen, if you have a spirit of fear and you are scared to come up here to this altar and surrender to the things of Jesus, grab a friend and bring them to pray with you and lay it down. There is no fear here. This is a hospital for the broken. We are supposed to be unified in Christ. We are the body of Christ. We are family. We don't have to hide those things from each other. We can be there to support each other. So I encourage you, if you're carrying anything in here with you today, I don't care if you go to a different church. We still love you. We're glad you're here. Grab a family member. Come up here and pray. Lay it down at the feet of Jesus. Let's start a revival in our hearts, a revival in our spirits, so that we can actually be living the way Jesus did.
Darkest night. Come awaken the people. Come awaken the city.
Oh God, a revival, pour it out, pour it out. Every stronghold will crumble, and I hear the chains hit the ground. Oh God, a revival, pour it out, pour it out. Come awaken your people, come awaken your city. Oh God, a revival. Shepherd born courageous,
children now. You hear your children now. You are the same now. You are the same now. You answer prayers now. And you will answer now. You are the same now. You are the same now. You were provided.
Trading up with other families as Al jump to do that after church. Great to have you here to worship with us. So glad you came. We are going to be in Luke chapter 2 in the New Testament, if you want to turn there. But this is our month of Advent. And Advent, of course, means coming. It's the coming of Christ. And each week we lead up to the Advent. The first week was hope. And we had this promise of hope that would come. So work with me now. And so Christ brought hope to us. But also, not last week, but week before, we learned that it was the week of love. And Christ basically was God's love in person coming with us and coming down to be with us as our Savior. And then last week, of course, our children told us the story and reminded us the teachings of God. So this week is our one of joy. In the Advent of joy, I'm going to read to you out of Psalm chapter 5, verses 11 and 12. But let all who take refuge in you rejoice. Let them ever sing for joy and spread your protection over them, and those who love your name may exult in you. For you bless the righteous, O Lord. You cover him with favor as with a shield. And this week, we're going to talk about the message of joy that Christ has brought. So turn with me to the New Testament, to the book of Luke. Sorry, we're going through Acts and we took the time off. I'm still trying to get on that mental track. Matthew, Mark, Luke, going to be in chapter 2. And we're going to look at Luke chapter 2, starting with verse 8 through verse 20. Familiar story to a lot of people, but we're going to look at it a little more in depth today too to see if we can see a little bit more out of God's message of joy in this. And in the same region there were shepherds out in the field keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with great fear. And the angel said to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly hosts, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased." When the angels went away from them into the heavens, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go over to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us." And they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger. And when they saw it, they made known the saying that had been told to them concerning the child. And all who heard it wondered at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured up all these things, pondering them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen as had been told to them. When we think about Christmas, we think about gifts. We know we're going to be getting gifts. And the thing about gifts is interesting. They kind of fall under two kind of categories for us. One is, "Ooh, wow, this is what I really wanted. This is what I love." But one of the things that we don't always get at first is the memories that are going to come with these gifts. And we all have those. Some memory that we have, maybe it was the gift itself, but more importantly, it was the person who gave it. We always say it's the thought that counts. And we usually don't have that memory until the person who gave it is gone away. One thing I forgot to bring this morning was a pocket knife that I have my grandfather gave me. It's just a little case knife. My grandfather was always giving me a pocket knife. And I would do what every child would do when you used to get pocket knives back. We used to give those out more, by the way, kids, back in the day when we didn't care about safety as much. But I would do what every kid did. I'd cut my finger with it and then lose it. And then until I was about 7th or 8th grade, I went to visit my grandfather. And he said, "Jason, do you have a nickel?" And I said, "Oh, yeah, I got one right here." And he said, "Okay, let me have that." And he said, "I'm going to sell you this knife." I said, "I found out it's bad luck to give anybody a knife, so I'm going to sell it to you at a really good deal." I said, "Oh, well, thanks, Grandpa." My grandfather died in 1989. He was in his 80s, and he went home to be with the Lord. But at that time, I quit carrying that knife because I was afraid I would lose it after that. So I put it away, and I don't carry it anymore, but I still have that knife to this day. Now, again, it's not the best knife I've ever had or anything like that, but I always remember this is the knife my grandfather sold me to get this. By the way, I don't give knives to my kids. I sell them to your kids, to mine. All right, so it's a good knife. I didn't give it to them. But these gifts that we give bring these memories because of the relationships that we have with them. And as we look at this today, we're going to see that this is God bringing this relationship to us through His Son, Jesus. And any relationship you have that you want to be a part of, at least, is one that really brings you joy. Not just happiness. Happiness is kind of an event, the happening, and things like that. But joy is this sustained enjoyment and sustained contentment with this and more desiring of it. That's what we have in joy. Okay. But as we look at this, I want you to know this. The joy of the gospel literally meaning the good news, the joy of the gospel is that now all people have a Savior. And every one of us in this room is included in that phrase, all people. I don't know what you've done. Some of you I do, and I won't tell, but I know. Some of you I don't know, but it doesn't matter. Because we all fall into that category of all people, and we have a Savior. So now, familiar story that we've had, we're going to catch up with this. We have Mary and Joseph, they had to go, because of the census, back down to Bethlehem, the city of David, where they were both actually descendants of David and from, so they had to go back down there. When they got there, there was no room for them in the inn, correct? Actually, the word there can also be translated the guest house. There was no room for them in the guest house. Later, Jesus stays with somebody, and it's the same word. They just translated it as guest house there and not inn. So basically, they're staying with family when they go down there, but there's no more room for them. And some of you guys know what that is, because that's why you get stuck on the floor or on the couch. There's no more room for you. But since Mary's going to have the baby, they have to put them out in the back by the stable. And this is where Jesus is born and things like that. Now, this, by the way, we shared before, this is about an 80-mile journey for them that they would have had to walk. We don't have any record that they rode animals or anything like that. As far as we know, they walked and carried stuff. And so that's how they go. Now, if you looked at it today, by the way, this is Jerusalem, this is Bethlehem, and yes, this is the West Bank. So if you get to go over there, Julie and I were blessed to be able to go over there, and we got to go into the Bethlehem, into the church of Nativity there in Bethlehem, and see the spot where Jesus was born. And we had to go through a few guard checks to get in there and things like that because of all the turmoil that's going on that you guys know about. But as we look at this story today, I want you to think about the joy of what this is. And the first thing that happens is these guys get a message. This message is delivered to them. Now, look at how this message came. In the same region, there were shepherds out in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night, and an angel of the Lord appeared to them. Okay? So the first part of this message is the angels appeared. Now, this word angel, by the way, literally means messenger. It's the Greek word angelos. It means messenger. And these were God's messengers. They came straight from God and they gave a message to these shepherds who were living in the field. They were out there. They were in the field watching their sheep. It was at nighttime. So, and this is, you know, I'm splitting hairs, but I'm just going to tell you the historical parts here too. It says they were watching their sheep. And usually in children's plays, we always have the shepherds asleep, don't we? They probably weren't asleep. Some of them might have been, because there's always that one guy, right? But most of them were probably awake, watching their sheep, making sure that some of the animals, like coyotes or wolves or whatever they might hunt at night, didn't come in and take them. So they're awake. But you have to understand that while they're awake, they see something in the sky. You and I do that, and we're going to look up and go, oh, must be an airplane. Back in the 60s and 70s, we would have been calling a hotline going, it's a UFO. And the government would have said, no, it's just a weather balloon. And you would have gone in and gotten your little tinfoil hat on just in case. No, I'm kidding. You wouldn't do that. But imagine these shepherds. They don't see airplanes flying. They have no concept of weather balloons. Nothing is in the sky but the moon and stars. That's all they ever see up there. But all of a sudden, one night, as they're watching and they're hanging out, talking about the sheep and maybe talking about their lives and maybe talking about the game coming up on Sunday. You know, it could have been any of those things. All of a sudden, this bright light appears and it's an angel. There's this person hovering above them. No wonder it says they were fearful. That's kind of a downplay on it. Literally, it says they feared a great fear. These guys were just a second from having a heart attack, if you want to know how scared they were. And they see this, so the first thing the angel says to them is, everybody say it with me, fear not. In other words, don't be afraid. It's okay. It's not okay. We see somebody floating above us. That's not okay. We're not used to that. And I'm sure some of those guys probably thought, these sheep are on their own. I'm out of here. I didn't sign up for this, all right? Wolves and bears I can handle, but stuff floating in the air, that's not cool. So it has their full attention as they're there in the field and they're listening to them. They see us, but they're scared to death by what they see. And let me tell you also about shepherds. This was not the most attractive job to ever get. Usually it was probably a family job passed on because your dad was a shepherd and his dad was a shepherd and that kind of thing. But this was not the most attractive job to get because you had to work with sheep all day. You had to be out in the field for, you know, a long time at a certain time and be gone. So you didn't eat or sleep and shower or clean very well and things like that. People didn't like to hang out with shepherds a lot for those obvious reasons. They were kind of a little lower on the social classes. Oh, he's a shepherd. Well, appreciate your work. Honestly, it's kind of how you would think about a garbage man. We need them. Thank goodness for them. But how many times have you ever gone out to your garbage man when they showed up and shook hands with them and said, oh, so glad, thank you guys for being here. No, you usually go, thank goodness they're here. Woo, that was dark smell. That's what we treated them like, and that's what they treated them like. So they literally showed up, if you want to say it this way, they showed up to the lowest of the low first. This wasn't God's first time to ever choose shepherds to be a messenger. It was Moses who was watching the flocks for his father-in-law when God showed up in a burning bush and said, Moses, I'm going to set my people free and you're going to go tell Pharaoh to do it. David was watching the sheep because they said he had to. Samuel was coming to anoint the king, so everybody had to go in. Except for you, David, you have to stay and watch the sheep because you're the youngest. And as Samuel went there, he went down each of Jesse's sons. Nope, not this one. Nope, not this one. Nope, not this one. And Samuel said, Jesse, are you sure these are all your boys? Because I don't get it. God said he was going to anoint one. And he said no to all these. Well, there is one more, but he's out watching the sheep. In other words, he didn't even count. We didn't bring him in. And yet that's who God chose. We always think of God starting at the top and working his way down to where he can reach some of us. God's never done that. If you want to read scripture, he usually starts at the bottom and brings everybody else up with him. So no matter who you are in here, you're not too far away to experience this joy that the angel is going to be telling the shepherds about. I don't know who you are, what you've done, or why you think you're so far away, but that's exactly where God goes first. Those who are farthest away. Well, we have these shepherds, and then he brings... Come on, work with me. There we go. Brings them this message. Fear not, behold, I bring you good news. And that literally means the gospel of great joy that will be for all people. A Savior is born to you. And he says, listen, this good news, this gospel, this is for all people. Genesis chapter 12, verse 3. God is talking to a man, Abraham, who becomes the father of this nation. And he says, Abraham, through you, by the way, I'm going to bless every family on earth. And here he is to all people. Yes, you shepherds. Yes, you great high priests and everyone in between. This is a Savior for you. It's for all people. And by the way, those of you who say I'm not very religious, Christ came for you too. Because while you're not religious, you still are a creation of God, and therefore he cares for you. Even if you don't accept him, he has always wanted you. He tells him you're going to find him in the city of David, a Savior, Christ the Lord. And in this, he covers every part of this message of who Christ is. First, he doesn't say Bethlehem. Remember, they're right beside of Bethlehem. They're literally like right outside the city. He doesn't say, oh, go to Bethlehem. He says, the city of David. Now, they knew what Bethlehem was. It was called the city of David, but this is his message. This is the promised one that comes from the line of David. This is also the Savior, the Deliverer, who's going to be the one to actually save his people, to save all people. But the Jews were looking for that Savior who was going to come and save us. What they didn't realize was God came to save all of us, not just the Jews. But this is also Christ the Lord. This is God in the flesh. And that is who you shepherds are looking for. He sends them on. Amazing. And he tells them this. Peace among those who please God. Now some of your Bibles, a lot of them will probably say peace, goodwill towards men. What God is saying here is that this is going to bring peace, and they're bringing peace and offering to those who please God. Now, those who have peace with God are those who know God. The only way to have peace with God is to be in that relationship with God. The problem is, how do you get into a relationship with a God you cannot reach, and He's at a level that you cannot get to? Somebody has to make a way. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And He says, I come that you would be able to become the children of God. And once you have that relationship, the one thing you can have that you can rest assured in is peace with God. Because no matter what happens in your life, as you read the book of Ecclesiastes, if you want to, it's a great book if you really want some depressing news. It says nothing matters. Because at the end of your life, whether you're rich, whether you're poor, whether you're smart, whether you're dumb, whether you worked hard, whether you were lazy, whatever, at the end of your life, guess what? You die. That should be on a Hallmark card somewhere, shouldn't it? It'd be a whole new branch they would bring out. The Ecclesiastes version. I only give it to your enemies first. He says, that's the whole thing you got to look for. So what in the world does life even matter? And at the very end, he brings out and he says, listen, the one thing I know is that we walk with God, and our whole duty is to worship Him. Here is our opportunity now that we can have peace with God for an eternity. Even if we don't have it with other people all the time, we can always have it with God. An amazing thing. We have this message that was delivered, but we also have this gift that was received, because they go to find Mary, and they go to Bethlehem. Of course, they have all the sheep there. I don't know if they left some people to watch the sheep, if they took all the sheep, or they just said, forget the sheep, we've got to go to Bethlehem. We don't know exactly because it doesn't say, but we just know that they went to Bethlehem, and they went immediately. It says they went with haste, and they didn't wait or anything like that, because they're right there. It's still nighttime, by the way, so but they still go, and they go with haste. They go immediately. They didn't wait. How do you think we should go? Dude, an angel just appeared in the sky. And by the way, after that angel, the whole host, which literally means an army of angels, showed up and began to sing. Yeah, I think we're going. So they go to this Bethlehem. They go into the town. They know what they're looking for. They've been told. So they found Mary and the baby. They're told what to look for. They said, listen, you're going to find a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths lying in a manger. That's going to kind of weed out a lot of them. They know where to find a manger. You find a manger in a stable. The kids in a barn? Yes, that's what they said. Okay. And if you know the story, you know that just before this, in verse 7 of chapter 2, it says that Mary took her baby, wrapped him in swaddling cloths, and laid him in the manger. And again, that word swaddling, we use that word now as a verb all the time. In our language, we say, oh, you got to swaddle the baby. You wrap it up really tight. Especially when they're newborn, because they like that. They've been in the real cramped environment in there, and now they get to come out, and they don't always like that. They like to be swaddled closely. But this word swaddling literally means torn cloths. In other words, she just tore up cloths and wrapped the baby, and tore it more and wrapped the baby, kind of like a homemade thing. So that's going to tell them exactly who they're looking for. Not that there's probably going to be a lot of kids lying in a manger out in the stables, I'm sure, but they're going to know what to look for, and they get this because the angels told them already. And they're going to see this, and they find this baby, and they get there. They give them the sign by the angel. Okay. Come on. Modern technology hates me. Something about shepherds. They're not going to be intimidated by a barn. They've been in barns a lot. Matter of fact, these are shepherds. They're probably thinking, oh, good, it's a barn. We can go indoors. Yet if they had to go to the palace, they would probably be a little hesitant. When the wise men come, a little bit later in the story, if you don't know it, you can read ahead. It's okay. The wise men are going to come, and they go to the king first. They go to the palace because that's what they're used to. We're looking for the same thing these shepherds are looking for, but yet we look in different spots. The shepherds are like, we don't go to palaces. Nobody brings us there. As a matter of fact, the only time we go to the temple is when we take the sheep around the back so they can use them for offerings. That's kind of our job. That's where we are in life. They wouldn't have been intimidated by a barn. But yet they knew when they got in that barn, it wasn't just any baby. They knew something definitely
was big going on here. Now, after this, the joy was shared. They got in there. They saw it. They made known the saying that had been told to them concerning this child. In other words, they told everybody what the angel said. They said, listen, this was the crazy thing. This angel showed up. And I can't help think if they were a little hesitant of saying that. I don't know if I would come in here and tell you, hey, guess what? An angel appeared in my backyard. And this is what he told me. And everybody going, okay, Brother Jason, let's go talk to someone first. I have a friend down at the hospital. Maybe they came in and go, hey, listen, I know this looks crazy. You don't know any of us, but we were watching the sheep and this angel appeared. The difference is Mary and Joseph probably went, oh, we don't doubt that bit. Matter of fact, we've heard from a few angels ourselves. We never know how people are going to receive any kind of message that God gives us. But what we don't know is what God's doing on the other side. That God has already been at work there. So when we go to present these messages that God has given us, we're hesitant thinking, what's going to happen, God? And God's like, I'm already three steps ahead of you. Just keep going. Tell this message. And they told it publicly. It says they told everyone. Literally, it means that they told it publicly. So they were maybe hesitant, but they told everyone. They didn't discriminate. They just said, listen, guys, you guys got to hear this. The angel came and he told us who this was going to be. And everyone marveled at it. The word wondered there means literally they marveled at that. They said, really? An angel? They told you to come here to look for this baby? Why? It says Mary treasured these things up. If anybody in that building knew who that baby really was, it was Mary. Nobody better than Mary knew this was a virgin-born baby. Nobody better than Mary knew what God's message was before that. Nobody better than Mary knew that this was not just another birth, just another baby. Mary knew this. And as she's hearing all these people just gasping and oohing and awing, just amazed, she's going, I know. I know what this means. Or pondering, of course, says she pondered him in her heart. Sometimes we think of pondering as trying to think about it and trying to figure it out. She knew, but the word literally means to meditate on it. She just constantly was thinking. And maybe she was thinking, where's all this going to go in the future? I mean, this is obviously a special child and God has called us something special, but what's going to happen? And that's a question we all have as parents. What's this kid going to grow up to be like? And then when we see our spouse and go, oh no, that could be a possibility. I'm just kidding. That's just what my wife says about my kids. But she was wondering, what is all this really going to mean, God, for this baby? This is special. This can't be just anybody. The shepherds left there. And it says, the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen as it was told to them. These shepherds now have gotten this greatest message ever. And they got it straight from God, right through the angels, the messengers. And now they were given the duty to go and to first see Christ, to behold this, and now they cannot help but tell what's happened. You can no longer keep those shepherds from telling the story of what happened than you can a woman not telling that she just got engaged. And you know when a woman gets engaged, they walk in the room like this. How's everybody doing? It's so hot in here. I'm going to have to take this room off. You're laughing because you know it's true. It's big news. It's huge. It's life-changing. Nothing will ever be the same. And that's what these shepherds now felt. Yes, they went right back out to the field, right back out to the same sheep they had left, doing the same job they did every day, probably for the rest of their lives. But the rest of their lives were never the same. Because every day they could remember, do you remember that time the angel showed up? Do you remember what they told us? That baby is the Savior of the world. Now I'll tell you this. These shepherds had to have the same faith everyone in the Old Testament did. Because more than likely, these shepherds didn't live another 33 years to see Christ hanging on a cross or risen from the grave. But yet they lived every day of their life knowing the promise that was given them had come true. And now as believers, you and I both live in the promise being fulfilled that Christ did come. He did die. He did raise again. But the promise that Christ is returning. And we live in between those two promises now. And that's the same way these shepherds would have felt. Now, how do we live this out? Well, first off, do you realize you need a Savior? Are you one of those people that think, I'm just too far away? Because there's two kinds of people that come up to God that have to make a decision about Christ. One is, I don't really need God. I'm doing pretty good. Or I don't believe in God. I don't fall for that. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Everyone in here needs a Savior, whether you realize it or not. Just like everyone in here needs oxygen, whether you thought about it or not. The other side of that is those who know they need God, who know they're sinners, who want to, but yet feel so far away that there's no way God would accept me. I've done too much. If you knew my story, you probably wouldn't want to talk to me either kind of stuff. That's exactly why God starts at the bottom and says, listen, to you a Savior is born for all people. And for those of you who say, well, I know I need Christ, but I'm not as bad as some of these other people. If God can reach them, there's no excuse that He wouldn't reach you then. And everywhere in between. But how do you share the good news of Christmas? This is Christmas, and we talk about it all the time, and it's the reason for the season and all this stuff. But have you honestly stopped and shared the good news about what this really means? Have you actually brought light into this dark world by saying, do you know why we have Christmas? Do you know it's not just for gifts? It's so that we can thank Jesus. It's a little more than that. Do we know this because God gave us hope, because we were hopeless? We had nothing to look forward to except dying. But now we have life eternal. Do we realize that because of His love, not just because He had to do it, not just because He didn't have anything else better to do, it wasn't done by accident, it was on purpose for the very intention that He loved us. And we know now that because of that, we have a reason that no matter how life goes, we know how it ends, and we can always have joy, even at the worst of times in our lives. That nothing would separate us from Him and take us out of His hand. His words, not mine. Gospel of John. And because of that, we have every reason to rejoice. Listen. Sometimes we don't understand what joy is and what it means to be saved. This is a man's name, Chester Zuber. He's from Detroit, Michigan, technically outside of Detroit. And in 1994, he was about 56 years old, and he was faced with a situation. He had to have a heart transplant. Started having heart attacks when he was in his 30s, 40s, and 50s. He'd already had two or three bypasses and heart attacks and everything. The doctor said, Chester, you're not going to make it unless you get a heart. And he had to get one. And in 1994, he received a heart transplant. He was able to get one. And his donor was a young lady named Patty Zuber, who was 22. It was his daughter. See, she was going down to Tennessee from Michigan with her friends and going to the Great Smoky Mountains on a great camping trip. And unfortunately, she was killed in a car accident. And they told Chester, they said, if you want her heart, you can have it. And he immediately said, no. No, there's no way I could do that, knowing that every heartbeat would remind me of Patty. There's no way I could live my life that way. And he said in an interview later, walking down the hallway, it took him so long to walk because of his health. He said, it's like the whole way, he said, I know this sounds corny, but it's like the whole way I could hear Patty pleading with me to take it. So finally he said, if the whole family will agree to it, then I'll do it. And the whole family said, yes, do it. And he took her heart. And he went back, and sure enough, it worked. He became healthy. He opened up his Christmas tree farm again in a berry farm. And inside that farm in Michigan, Berkeley, Michigan, you can find Patty's Park. And in there he finds the trees and all the beautiful things. But in the middle of the park, he left one dead tree with broken branches. He said, that's to remind us of a life cut short. Now, amazingly, as far as I could tell, Chester's still alive. He'd be 87 now. His wife died in 2013. He was about 80. He did another interview after all the years of this. And he said, you know, I didn't want to get the heart this way. He said, but every day I can have her heartbeat in me and I can be reminded of what a joy she is. Because see, not only did he get her heart, but two blind ladies received her eyes and they can now see. Two other people received her kidneys. They now have fuller lives. And another person got her liver. And he said, I know that she's obviously one of the happiest people in heaven right now. Listen, the cost of a Savior is deep. But the love and the joy and the life that it brings goes deeper. This baby that they are looking at is going to grow up to be nailed to a cross, to be put in a grave. But yet, 3 days later, he will raise again so that we would never be separated from him again for eternity. That's the joy that we can hold on to. No matter what life brings to us, we will never be separated. Will you pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for giving us a Savior, for giving us truly not just a present, but a person who would love us, who would walk with us, who would live with us, and who would die for us, and who would raise again to show us what true eternal life is. Thank you again for that love. Thank you again for that hope. Thank you again for that joy. And Father, you know every life out here. Father, everyone out here is needing a Savior from day to day. But Father, I pray they know they're not too far away. I pray they know they're not too far above, that you couldn't reach them because you came for us. Thank you again for your love and your grace, for dying for us at the cross of Calvary. And now as we go into this time of... Sorry, I'm trying to save those for another week. Now as we go into this time of invitation. We will not go long because we do have our baptisms coming, but I want to give you just a moment. As we look at this season and the joy and things like that, life is not always joyful. Life is not always easy. But there's not a reason it can't be full. There's not a reason it can't be with purpose. And the difference is Christ brings that. And that's the only thing that brings it. That's why we share that verse at the beginning. There's salvation found in no other name except Jesus. So as we open this time of invitation, this altar is open for whatever you need. You can come down and talk to me. My wife Julie will be here. Ladies, if you prefer to talk with or pray with a lady, she'll be here. Or you can come and pray by yourself. This is the time when you need to actually think about, Lord, what is my walk with you right now? What is your relationship? Are you well pleased in me, Lord? Lord, also, what has my life been like? Have I lost that joy that I had knowing that I was one of your children for eternity? Or have I gone back to my humdrum life just like it always was? Nothing's changed. Whatever your need is, I'm down here to talk with you. We can talk now, we can talk later, we can come pray by yourself. But whatever you need, stand with us as we sing. This altar is open for you.
God rest you, Mary, gentle, and I think you deserve Jesus.
Scripture. We do not believe that you are saved because you are baptized. We believe that you are baptized because you are saved. The Bible says that you are to repent and then be baptized. And we believe that this is a part of your confession, your public confession of your belief in Christ. And that's what these folks have done. They have all accepted Jesus Christ, and they want to make this public profession of it. Now, this is also done as symbolism, because it's not the water that washes away the sin, it's the blood of Christ. But this is to show how this works, that these folks have walked with God and that they will be buried just like their sin was buried. It is long gone. It is dead. It is gone. But just as Jesus rose from the grave, they now raise from the water to walk a new way of life. They will no longer be old. The Bible tells us in 2 Corinthians 5:17 that if anyone is in Christ, all things have become new. All things have passed away. He is a new creation, a new creature in Christ. And that's how they're going to portray, they're going to profess this today. But also, just like the water covers them and makes them look different, we believe that on the inside, the Holy Spirit comes and makes us look completely different, makes us a new person. And that's why we're doing this today. So if you have come today and you have come to support one of these people who have come, will you just raise your hand or stand up, either one? We'd love to see it. Thank you guys for doing that. We appreciate that. And continue to pray for them as well.
Thank you, Jason. As Jason had mentioned, we've got four wonderful, wonderful young people that have come to know Jesus Christ as their Savior. But you know what? They wanted, they decided, not anybody, they have decided to make it public. Amen. So the first one is going to be Miss Alexis. Come on down, Alexis. Miss Alexis Adams. Christ is her Savior. But I'm going to go just one step forward while she is here. Who is here to support Miss Alexis in her baptism? Raise your hand. Look at that. Look at all my boys. Thank you. All right. Alexis, do you believe that Christ died on the cross and rose again the third day to save you from your sin? She sure does. Based on your confession, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with them will be baptism, raised to newness of life. This is going to be emotional. My next three are my grandchildren, so I'm going to try to hold them together. So our next is Miss Carly Anderson. Carly Anderson is dying to make her profession of faith public. If you're here in support of Miss Carly, would you raise your hand?
Amen.
Support them and also coming out to worship with us. So remember, Wednesday night at 6:30, we're going to have our candlelight service. Love to have you here. Next Sunday, if you do not have a church home, if you do, by all means, go there. But if you don't have one, we'd love to have you here. We start at 10:30 with our worship. We'll have Sunday school starting after the first of the year. So will you stand with us as we pray? We'll be
dismissed. Hold on.
Hold on. 1 minute. My bad. One more. There's always something else I didn't know about. No?
Go
have a seat.
Recognizing the staff and representing the body of believers to give out some gifts to thank you for all the work. So a lot of we see what goes on Sundays, and some on Wednesday nights, but there's a lot more work that goes on after, you know, the other days and after hours. And so we said thank you and from the staff or from the body of believers. So as I call your name, if you would come down, Miss Francis.
It takes her a minute. She's behind the scenes.
Sharon.
You can tell our behind the scenes people don't like to be up in the front. We love them and we want you to know who they are for sure.
Thank you. Thank you. Scott are traveling, so keep them in your prayer for safe travel. Ms. Twyla, where you at? Where's Megan?
She's back there.
Thank you.
Nathan. Such a blessing today to see.
see the service, to see the baptism. It's been an awesome day. So, and just pray everybody has a blessed remembrance of our Savior and the greatest gift ever given, right? So,
amen.
Thank y'all. God bless.
Awesome. Let me close in a word of prayer. And I hope you don't have to just rush right off and get to shake hands and get to see some folks. Maybe meet somebody new, but at least get to greet some folks before you go out. Will you stand with us as we pray? Dear Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for this reason of joy to come and celebrate. Lord, thank you for these four more lives that we know for eternity we get to spend with them. And Lord, they would never be separated from us, but mostly, Lord, they'd never be separated from you. Father, we look with awe and wonder and excitement as to what the days ahead, how you're going to continue to use them for your kingdom's work. Father, thank you for that, Lord. Thank you for letting us be a part of that even today. And Father, it's in your name we pray, Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you for coming.